So this is a 10-year-old previously healthy female who had failed her school vision screening exam for fourth grade. 2 years prior, she had had a school vision screening exam, which she passed without any difficulty. So the school recommended that she go get an eye exam, and she was referred to an optometrist. Her right eye was 20/20, and her left eye was 20/200, and he noted a pale optic nerve. The patient denied any decreased visual acuity that she was aware of. She had had no problems in school or seeing the board. So she came into neuro-ophthalmology clinic. Her past medical history, she had had a tumor in her index finger on her right hand. This was removed in Mexico. She had a post-operative infection, and there was some concern about the surgeon. So mom wasn't sure what, if any, studies had been done on that tumor. She had an unremarkable birth history. She was developmentally normal. There was no unexplained vision loss in the family. She was not on any medications, and she had no allergies. So on exam, her visual acuity in the right eye was 20/20. In the left, she was 20/200. She had decreased stereo vision, and in the left eye, her color vision was decreased. Her pupils in light were 3 millimeters bilaterally, and in dark were 5 millimeters. She had a 0.9 log APD on the left. Her visual fields on the left were constricted to confrontation. She had some mild proptosis. Her extraocular movements were full. And on her fundoscopic exam, her left optic nerve was very pale. So she was sent for an MRI, and this is the MRI of her brain. This is an axial T2 with contrast. And this was read as bilateral vestibular schwannomas. And they're most easily seen at the cerebellar pontine angle, and they're described as porous here. And this is the most recent of her MRIs, and at this point, this is her actually second MRI. There was involvement of not just the eighth nerve, but the facial nerve as well. And then also in her brain MRI, responsible for her proptosis and her loss of visual acuity, she has a left optic nerve sheath meningioma, which you can see. So this constellation of findings is consistent with neurofibromatosis type 2. This is caused by a mutation in the NF2 tumor suppressor gene, which is on 22Q12. There approximately occurs 1 in 25,000 births, so Utah has about 60,000 births a year, so there should be about 2 to 3 cases a year. It's autosomal dominant. The most common finding is the bilateral vestibular nerve schwannomas. You can also have meningiomas, ependymomas, astrocytomas, and neurofibromas, and neurofibromatosis too are quite rare. And then the ocular findings, which we'll be talking about, include cataracts, epiretinal membranes, and then retinal hamartomas. NF type 1 is a phenotypically and genetically distinct disorder. That's on 17Q11 in the gene. And that is does have cafe au lait spots, many more neurofibromas as well. So in diagnosis, approximately 50% do not have a family history. The Manchester criteria is used for diagnosis. So if a patient has bilateral vestibular schwannoma, you don't need additional findings for diagnosis. And then if they have a positive family history, you need either a unilateral vestibular schwannoma or 2 NF2 associated lesions. So meningioma, glioma, a neurofibroma, a schwannoma, or a cataract. If they have a unilateral vestibular schwannoma, then you need 2 other NF2 associated lesions. And if you have a patient with multiple meningiomas, you need either a unilateral vestibular schwannoma or 2 other associated lesions. The average age of diagnosis is 20 years of age, but the delay in diagnosis is approximately 7 years. There is a childhood onset form, and those patients more often present with visual disturbances, so the cataracts, hamartomas, or intracranial tumors. They can also present with skin tumors, which likely was the earliest manifestation that our patient had. Also mononeuropathy, so they can present with facial paresis or foot drop. 30% will present with hearing loss. There was a study done by Bosch in Zurich, and she's an ophthalmologist. It was published in the American Journal of Ophthalmology in 2006, and she did a retrospective observational study and had 30 patients that had come to their clinic. And she found that 10 years after the first symptoms, all of these patients had at least 2 CNS tumors. Then for the later onset, NF2, these patients are more likely to present with hearing loss from the vestibular schwannomas. About 92% will have hearing loss. They also can complain of tinnitus, dizziness, or imbalance. And then Bosch found that only 11% of these patients at 10 years after their symptom onset had two or more CNS tumors. So the frequency of the lesions that are associated with NF2, bilateral vestibular schwannomas, you'll see a 90 to 95%. Cataracts, you'll see in 60 to 81%, which was similar to what Dr. Bosch had found. Epiretinal membranes, you'll see in 12 to 40%, and then retinal hamartomas in 6 to 22%. So here, I'm going to go through just the neurological manifestations or the other tumors, and then we'll talk a little bit more in detail about the ocular findings. So this is an axial T1 image with contrast of the brain, which shows the bilateral vestibular schwannomas with the arrow point here. And then you have extension of the schwannoma. And then here you have a dumbbell-shaped schwannoma, which is actually pressing on the spinal cord here. This is a schwannoma, which is involving the intercostal nerve. And then here is the H&E staining, which you see spindle cells. And you also see Antoni A and B cells as well. The meningioma is the second most common tumor found in NF2. 45 to 58% of patients will present with this. Often there'll be at least more, there'll be more than one. And this, if they have a meningioma, this will increase their mortality. It also increases the morbidity if it originates from the optic nerve sheath. And 20% of children who are presenting with a meningioma will actually have NF2. So if you have a patient that has a meningioma, this should NF2 should be on your differential. For the ependymoma, here you see the C7, this kind of swelling here, and then this is post-contrast. And something that's distinctive of this is kind of string of pearls appearance in the spinal cord. This accounts for 75% of intramedullary spinal cord tumors. It's present in 18 to 53% of patients, but it's symptomatic in less than 20%. And for those patients that are symptomatic, they'll have back pain, weakness, or paresthesias. The cutaneous manifestations, so skin tumors will be seen in about 59 to 68% of patients. These often are plaques, so you can have hyperpigmentation and hypertrichosis. These are usually small plaques, less than about 2 centimeters. You can also have subcutaneous tumors along the peripheral nerves and intradermal tumors, which are most often schwannomas. Café au lait, though, it's much more common in neurofibromatosis type 1. You can have this in neurofibromatosis type 2, except it's often singular. So in neurofibromatosis type 1, for the diagnosis, you have to have more than 6 lesions, and they have to be greater than 15 millimeters, depending on the age group. But in neurofibromatosis, you can still have a café au lait spot. It's usually just one. And this was true of our patient. She had a café au lait spot. The ocular findings, so you'll find cataracts in 60 to 81% of patients. They're usually found in the posterior subcapsular or capsular regions, or you can have cortical lenticular opacities. Only cataracts in patients that are less than 50 years old can be considered part of the constellation of NF2, and they interfere with vision in approximately 10 to 25% of patients. The second common finding is epiretinal membranes. These usually are not the cause of loss of visual acuity in patients. You can also find retinal hamartomas. Frequently, these do reduce visual acuity. You can also see disc gliomas, or as in our patient, an optic nerve sheath meningioma. So here's some photos of the ocular findings. So here's the cataract in the post-subcapsular and capsular region, and then this picture is actually a magnification here of the wedge cataract in the peripheral cortical region. And then this picture is an epiretinal membrane, and then this picture is a retinal hamartoma. Again, here are a couple of pictures. So here, the first picture you see posterior and anterior subcapsular lens opacity, and then the peripheral cortical cataract is right here. And I think it's a little bit difficult to see the epiretinal membrane in this picture, but they're pointing it out here. And then in the last picture, the patient has an epithelial hamartoma. And then here are just a couple other pictures of the epiretinal membrane, which I believe is right here. This patient had an optic disc glioma. Her onset was at a very young age, and the course of her disease was very severe, which is most of the early presenting cases are more severe. This is a patient who had several surgeries for tumor debulking. She has an optic nerve sheath meningioma here. She had a multilobar vestibular schwannoma, which you can see here. And then she also had bilateral meningiomas here. This chart is from the study done by Bosch. So she had 30 patients, and there were ocular findings in 25% of the 25 of the 30 patients on their initial exam. And for the childhood onset cases, 94% of these patients had visual symptoms. This probably is a little bit elevated because of a referral bias for her, and also that the childhood onset are more often very, present with visual symptoms early. So these patients had, as is typical of NF2, cataracts, epiretinal membranes, and optic meningioma. And then on the adult onset patients, only 67% of those patients had initial ocular findings on their first exam. So the first line here are the number of eyes that were involved, and this is the number of patients and the associated findings. So for disc edema, 7 patients with 12 eyes had disc edema. All of their disc edema resolved, but these two patients right here were new onset disc edema at their follow-up visit. The exophthalmos was due to intracranial tumors. And the lid dysfunction was often related to tumor resection that might have involved the facial nerve or Horner syndrome for those patients. So our patient had a 6-month follow-up, and at that time her vision in her left eye was still 20/200. Her afferent pupillary defect was a little more severe. It was logged at 1.2, and she still had a pale optic nerve. Her Goldman visual fields, which I think are showing right here, are constricted and depressed in the left eye. She had an audiology evaluation, which was normal. She saw genetics, who ordered an MRI of her spine and did genetic testing. So when you see a patient with neurofibromatosis, in particular a child, they get referred to the Neurofibromatosis Center at Primary Children's, which is nationally renowned. They found the gene for NF1, and they will see the patient. So unless the patient is having seizures or headaches or weakness, they don't usually get referred to neurology, but they go to the NF clinic. And for this patient, they wanted an MRI of the spine. Because she had these cafe au lait spots and she also had some axillary freckling, they wanted to look for ependymomas in our patient, which she actually did have. And at that point in time, they were going to pursue genetic testing and then test the rest of her family. The patient was also evaluated by ENT and neuro-oncology. So the recommended screening intervals, these screening intervals are actually for a patient who has a family history of NF2. So for a child, they recommend at least an ophthalmological evaluation yearly, a neurological exam yearly, which doesn't have to be done by a neurologist, audiology evaluation with brainstem evoked potentials, and then a brain MRI at 10 years of age and a spinal MRI at the same time. So again, the average age of symptom onset is 20 years old, but the diagnosis is delayed on average approximately 7 years. Bosch found that through follow-up with her patients that 30% became completely deaf, 63% had marked hearing impairment, and only 7% of the patients had normal hearing. Markers for increased risk of mortality include an early age of onset and the presence of an intracranial meningioma. Yes, it does. Yeah. So it's particularly important because so many patients will become deaf to preserve as much of their vision as possible. So these patients should be referred very early. And one of the major problems with removing the meningiomas intracranial is that they can have a lot of facial weakness, and there's just a lot of morbidity associated with those surgeries. Questions? So unfortunately, our patient probably has a pretty poor prognosis because she has, the intracranial meningioma and the bilateral vestibular schwannoma that involve her facial nerve already. And then she has the ependymoma. So likely if that needs to be resected, she'll have lower extremity weakness. Mm-hmm. Thank you.